Welcome. This video is going to take a look at a high burst double melee build utilizing rapier and sword and shield that focuses on stuns and using them to guarantee the backstab mechanic. So I just have to say up front that this build is very challenging, but I am thoroughly addicted to it and it is extremely fun. And when you're able to pull off the burst combo, extremely satisfying. If you've ever seen the show Spartacus, there's a character, Gannicus, that is just an absolute legend, and he uses two one-handed swords like we do in this build, and he's basically just a super agile motherfucker, and he uses, you know, like his speed and his agility and his high burst to just like totally dick on people that are way bigger than him. And he's just, yeah, he's awesome as fuck. So I think like playing this build, you want to play it like Gannicus, where you're just a total badass and you're bobbing and weaving and you're really relying on your full dex build, your high agility to avoid strikes and, you know, dodge and parry and block them as much as you can, and utilizing your stuns to set up a huge burst combo and either executing someone outright with that, or if they're a little beefier, having the skill and patience to ride out your cooldown window until your combo's back up and executing it again. I think this build really shines in the 1v1, but it can be quite a bit more challenging to pull off in group PvP scenarios. And that's not to say that group PvP is not possible or not fun. You can absolutely dive into the carnage with all the great axes and heavy armor people, but it's kind of coin flip where sometimes that works out amazing and it's super awesome. Sometimes you just instantly get deleted. And then, yeah. I actually show a bunch of OPR clips later on in the combat mechanics section of the video, so you can really get a good feel of what group PvP is actually like with this build. I think the coolest way to play a build like this in an OPR scenario is trying to find flanks on light armor users. So like those pesky muskets that are always just doming you from 1,000 miles away, trying to flank and sneak up and just catch those people by surprise, especially if you can get it open with a backstab, is really fun. And I think is a really, you know, useful thing for your team in OPR, because no one likes just like getting fucking shot up by muskets. No offense to you musket players, I respect the musket, but it's pretty rough in OPR lately. It feels like all these void muskets just ripping. Another really cool thing you can do is carry a bow with you. And so at any point you can switch out your bow for your sword and shield and play the very strong known bow rapier build, or you can switch it out for your rapier like I usually do and rock shield archer, which is going to be the next guide I make after this one. And so I've kind of been playing both of these together as sort of a three weapon build over the last several weeks, and it has been an absolute blast. And this is just a really good way to not get frustrated if you're playing this build and you're just getting deleted over and over going into the melee. You can just switch one of those weapons for your bow and stand back and pump from a range and get your chill back, and then switch back to your rapier if you're feeling like it, or, you know, just keep pumping with bow. As far as PvE goes, it holds up really well and ended up being really fun because you can play it essentially the same way you play PvP. And so you can use just running around the world killing mobs as a way to practice your combat flow and, you know, figure out really in depth how your abilities synergize, get some really good practice working your backstab combo, which we're going to go over in a minute. And as long as a mob is stunnable, in the 1v1 against huge elite mobs, you can beast pretty hard too. In group PvE situations like invasions, it's also really fun because you have really high single target burst damage with your rapier and the way you get the evade reset. And so there's this really nice feel good light attack backstab evade reset rhythm that you can get going, and so you're a pretty good boss killer as long as you don't die. If you're really focusing on PvE and not planning on PvPing much, I have a variation of the build for you later in the video where we basically drop Fletch for Flurry, and it basically gives you an ultra mega backstab combo because mobs react not quite as quickly as players, and so you have a slightly larger window to just totally blast something before, you know, it turns around and starts to fuck with you. And so yeah, stick around for that. Alright, so here is the full build. Unfortunately, the website that I was using to show the build in its entirety, which was nwbuilds.gg, it doesn't look like it's being maintained anymore. It just has an error every time I try to load, which is unfortunate, but I found this nwdb.info website that has a pretty good one. It doesn't show the summary like the other one, but it does show the input order of the attributes, so you can kind of see how you would go as you level up your weapon skill. And so this is what we are working with now. This build is definitely possible without max weapon skill. Most of the PvP clips you see during this was around Sword and Shield level 17, Rapier level 13. And so as long as you have the Keystone for the Rapier and Evade fully upgraded, and your three ability upgrades filled out on Sword and Shield, I think you're in a pretty good place to make this build work. And it's really just all uphill from there, because you start picking up some of the things that make your backstab damage just get insane. So things like Perfectionist, where you deal 10% more damage when your health is full. On Guard, where you deal 10% more damage when your target has greater than 50% health. Desperation, where you deal 10% more damage when your stamina is below 40%. Stacking damage from your Opal, giving you 15% extra damage when you don't have full stamina. Having the 30% extra damage from the Momentum Keystone on your first Evade Light after your backstab. And then getting the 20% slow on the final attack of your light attacks with your Sword and Shield, and then that combined with Final Blow giving you 15% more damage on that third hit, and then having Opportunist where you deal 10% more damage to slowed foes, and you also deal 10% more damage to slowed foes on top of that from your 250 dex perk. Also, if you're able to land a Leaping Strike backstab, that's going to inflict a 50% slow for 8 seconds from the Cowardly Punishment upgrade. And so that gives you an even bigger window to take advantage of your bonus damage to slowed foes. And then on top of all that, you're going to get 30% more damage for 5 seconds when you're able to land a heavy with your sword with Empowered Stab. You also have Confidence with Sword and Shield, which gives you 50% bonus damage when you're at full health. And so if you need to, especially if you have Defiant Stance up and you don't want to drop the damage reduction, you can backstab with the sword. And then finally, you're going to be able to get Leadership, which I don't have throughout this whole video, but that's going to be the proverbial icing on the cake to make your Sword and Shield just pump. And super finally, you are going to get an extra 25% bonus damage on your backstab from your stacking dex perks. So here's a quick preview of the attribute split I've been using, which is basically mostly dex, and any gear pieces you end up picking up that have constitution as well as dex don't hurt, but it's really focused on really high burst, and you're really relying on your dodging and your riposte and your shield to not take damage. We're going to get into the details of the attributes and the gear and the perks in just a minute, but before that, I really just want to break down the burst combo, because this is basically what makes and breaks this build, is if you're able to execute this successfully. And when you're able to pull it off, it is very gratifying and you feel like a samurai, rogue, legend. One thing I want to mention real quick before that is that if you like playing double melee but great axe really isn't your jam, or you haven't really been able to find a double melee setup that scratches that itch for you, I really recommend giving this build a try. It's very different than anything I've played so far in the way it feels, just because you're trying to behave more like a shifty rogue that's relying on utility setup to lead into your burst combo, whereas a lot of the other double melee builds that have a great axe are more of sort of the warrior archetype, where you know you're flying in and there's definitely still setup and skill, but you're really relying more on the power of your autos and just keeping constant pressure and just hunting someone, chopping them down. They just feel very different. And so if you haven't done a melee build that's not great axe, I really recommend giving at least one of them a try, just because of how different of an experience it is. All right, so now we're gonna get into the burst combo. It's really not that complicated, and once you get the feel for it, it flows really nicely in combat. And so the combo really starts with Shield Bash, which is your 3 second stun. But what I found out is that you can actually use the Leaping Strike, and the stagger on that is long enough to guarantee your Shield Bash if you're able to hit your Leaping Strike. And so unlike Shield Rush, where if you hit someone with Shield Rush, they can actually have time to dodge your Shield Bash after that, even if you do it like as quick as you can, with Leaping Strike, especially if you have, you know, like minimal lag, the stagger off of connecting that is long enough to where you can almost always Shield Bash off of it, and then you're going into your combo. So as soon as you get your stun, which can also be off of riposte, which we're going to talk about in a minute, you want to move behind your target, and because of how efficient you are with stamina in a full dex build, I really like to dodge behind my target, and that activates the 15% bonus damage from the Opal in my rapier. And so right here is where you really get to unload, and let me just paint a picture of how much actual stacking damage you can have in the best case scenario when you're about to backstab someone. Okay, so you're hopefully going to have around 18% extra bonus damage on your rapier from the actual backstab perk, which is conveniently and appropriately named Rogue. And then you're going to have 15% bonus damage from your opal in your rapier because you're not at full stamina. And then if you're at full health, you're going to have 10% damage on top of that from Perfectionist. And if you happen to use the last of your stamina to get behind him, a lot of times you'll have enough time for it to fully reset, even if it went to gray. And in that scenario, you're going to have an extra 10% from Desperation being below 40% stamina. And we also can't forget about the stacking dex perks. And so we're also going to get 5% bonus to thrust damage from the 100 point dex perk, and the rapier attacks count as thrust. We're going to get 10% bonus backstab damage from the 200 point perk, and we are going to get 10% bonus critical hit damage on stunned enemies from the 250 point perk. So in these combos, both off of your shield bash and your riposte stun, you're in a situation where your target is stunned. You're going to get a guaranteed critical hit from backstabbing them, because that's how the backstab mechanic works in this game. If you're directly behind your target, it's a guaranteed critical hit. And so this backstab guaranteed crit on a stun target with thrust damage off both of your stun setups is really going to take full advantage of all of the damage perks provided by the dex tree. So with all this stuff stacked together, you have a potential of 88% bonus damage on your backstab in the perfect scenario if all this stuff lines up. And even if some of the more nuanced things like Perfectionist and Desperation don't line up, the minimum amount of guaranteed bonus damage you're going to have on your backstab is still 58% as long as you dodge behind him so that your opal is active. And so what you're going to do next is immediately, as quick as you possibly can, after you land your heavy attack backstab, you're going to evade forward and instantly light attack, like as fast as you can. And what evade does is it gives you an almost instant light attack. And so if you read the description of evade, perform a small reliable sidestep in your current movement direction that cancels any current activity and provides momentary invulnerability. Light attacks made during evade are performed exceptionally fast. And basically what you're trying to do is get that second light attack backstab in with the rapier almost instantly, as quick as you can after the heavy attack backstab, and very reliably you can get that second light attack in before the enemy player even has time to react and dodge to try to avoid that damage. And so not only is this second light attack going to be benefiting from that stacking bonus damage that we talked about for the heavy attack, but on top of that, it's going to get 15% bonus damage from the Adagio upgrade on your evade. And on top of that, it's going to get 30% increased damage from your Keystone Momentum, which increases damage on your next light or heavy attack after performing an ability. Ends on hit or after 3 seconds. So evade counts as an ability, you evade forward. So that's an extra 45% damage on top of the 88% bonus damage that you already had, minus 10% because they're not stunned anymore. So 78% plus 45% is going to give you a potential of 123% bonus damage on this evade light immediately following your heavy backstab. And that is the huge backstab burst that you're basically able to guarantee every time you get a stun. And the way the timing of this combo usually ends up working out is you're able to get your huge heavy backstab followed by your huge light backstab. They dodge almost immediately after that. And if you fletch as soon as you can after you're done with your evade light, oftentimes the timing is perfect to where that fletch will follow and hit them right when they come out of their dodge animation. And on top of that, because you've now exhausted your utility and your burst window, it usually puts you in a position where you have a little bit of space. And if you don't kill them, you can use your positioning to reset and wait for your cooldowns to come back up and go in for another combo. And so that's your big burst setup off of Shield Bash. And I think you want to try to use Shield Bash first because it has a longer cooldown. And so you want to get value and big damage off of that stun. And then you want to get it started on cooldown so you'll be able to use it again as quick as possible if the fight goes long. So once you've executed this combo with your Shield Bash, pretty much the only two abilities you have left that aren't on cooldown are Defiant Stance with your sword and shield and Riposte with your rapier. And so at this point, you have a couple options. Usually after you've fletched, you have a little bit of space. And so basically you can decide if you want to keep your rapier on and try to trade with your rapier. And in that scenario, you're using your dodges and your evade and the cooldown reduction you get on your evade from hitting your light attacks to DPS while avoiding damage. And the whole time you're looking for your opportunity to secure a riposte stun. And the other option is to pull out your sword and shield, pop Defiant Stance, and use your block and dodges to keep space and not take any damage and even heal up while you're waiting for everything to come off of cooldown. And so really which option you choose usually depends on if you're winning the fight or not. So if you're winning the fight at this point and you have more health and you can continue pressure with the rapier, I recommend doing that option because that will often lead into a riposte stun, which goes into another backstab combo, and that will often give you the damage for the kill. If you're in a tough spot and you're not winning the fight, switching to sword and shield and popping defiance stance to get that damage reduction going, and then using your block and your movement to kite and get away and heal up and avoid damage. And that whole time you're basically just waiting for your cooldowns to come back up so you can go in with another leaping strike into a shield bash. And if you're able to secure the stun from your riposte, you have 2.5 seconds instead of 3, and so it's still plenty of time to be able to get behind them and execute the same exact backstab combo, even if you don't have Fletch up. Additionally, when you're able to get your backstab off of riposte, as opposed to shield bash, you are going to be benefiting from momentum on the heavy attack from your rapier instead of on the light attack. And I'm honestly not sure if there is a built-in cooldown on this, but I don't think there is because it just works off of abilities, and so it counts, you know, your ability cooldowns as the cooldown for this keystone. And basically what momentum does, which we talked about earlier for the light attack, is it deals 30% increased damage on your next light or heavy attack after performing an ability, ends on hit or after 3 seconds. And so if you get a riposte stun is 2.5 seconds, you're guaranteed to have 30% increased damage on that heavy backstab with your rapier after that. And when you evade light right after that, you're gonna have 30% damage on your light as well, like you did off of the shield bash. And so when you're able to backstab with a rapier off of the riposte stun, you're actually gonna have a potential of 118% bonus damage on that heavy, because it's the 88% potential we talked about earlier, plus 30% from momentum. And then you're also gonna have the same amount on that light attack as we discussed earlier, the 123%, from all the stacking bonuses and momentum as well. And so a lot of times this one's gonna really hurt, and you can expect to try to keep pressure on after this because they're going to be trying to kite away and heal. And when in doubt, I think trading with the sword and shield, especially if you have Defiance Stance up, is always a good option and a good way to trade DPS while you're waiting for your cooldowns to come back up. And when you're just trading with sword and shield, if you're able to get a heavy attack in as soon as possible, that's going to give your sword 30% increased damage for the next 5 seconds from empowered stab. On top of that, the third attack with your sword is going to deal 15% more damage from final blow, and it's also going to slow them by 20% for 2 seconds from Achilles heal. And then you're going to deal 10% more damage to slowed foes from Opportunist. So every time you get that third attack, trying to follow it into another light attack chain or with a heavy is always a good call because they're slowed for 2 seconds and you have 10% more damage from Opportunist. And actually every time you have a foe slowed by your sword, you're going to be benefiting from 20% bonus damage because you get the 10% from Opportunist as well as the 10% from your 250 dex perk. Additionally, if you're able to find a longsword with Keen to give you that extra crit percent chance, that will stack with Precision, which gives you 10% increase crit chance with your swords anyways, and so you have a really good chance of critting at least one, sometimes a lot, of the attacks in this attack chain. And when you do that, you're going to benefit from Critical Precision, which gives you 20% haste for 5 seconds when you need to crit with your sword. And so a lot of times this, combined with the slow, you can use to really keep pressure up and continue the pursuit. And this is the main reason why I run an emerald with Opportunist in my longsword. I think you could also run an opal in your longsword with good success for the same reasons that it's good with the rapier, but I like having something different in my longsword so I don't have to plan the same way. And so basically this makes it so that when they drop below 30% health, you're doing 20% extra damage. And I found that a lot of times I'm chasing kills with my sword utilizing this 20% haste I have combined with the 20% slow. And so in that scenario when someone's low, a lot of times the longsword is the best option because it has a really wide range with the sweeping of the third attack, much more than the rapier. Additionally, it has better homing than the rapier, which means when you auto someone while you're aiming at them, if you're within a certain range, it'll actually sort of like lunge you forward. And so it's just a lot easier to hit someone and keep up the pressure if they're constantly trying to dodge and evade your attacks. And so this gem with the longsword ends up feeling really good and just makes it a lot easier to chase someone down and keep the pressure up and secure the kill. Last thing on this, in the scenario where someone's running away from you with less than 30% health, if you're able to land a leaping strike, a lot of times it just murders them because it's a backstab because they're running away, so it's guaranteed crit, and you're doing 20% more damage from your emerald, and if you heavy attack sometime in the last 5 seconds, you have 30% more damage from that, And if they're slowed from the third attack of your light chain, they'll be taking 10% more damage from Opportunist, as well as 10% more from the 250 dex perk. And in fact, this will also benefit from the other two bonus dex perks that we talked about. And so you get 5% more from the 100 point dex perk because it's a thrust attack, and you're going to get 10% more bonus damage on top of that from the 200 point dex perk because it's usually a backstab if they're running away. Also, when you just have your sword out, you're going to be getting 10% bonus damage from leadership. And if you still have full health at this point, you're going to be getting 15% more bonus damage from confidence. And finally, if you hit a foe below 30% health, you deal 50% more damage with the final strike upgrade of your leaping strike. And so if you're able to line up all this stuff for a leaping strike on someone that's low that's running away from you, you have a potential of 160% bonus damage on that attack from all this stuff stacked. And so basically that means if you hit that, you're probably going to kill him. And in this scenario where you don't get the kill for some reason because they heal or something, or if you are able to get a leaping strike backstab on someone that's above 3% health, you're going to benefit from cowardly punishment, which inflicts a 50% slow for 8 seconds. And remember, you're always dealing 20% more damage to slowed foes from Opportunist and your 250 dex perk. And you can actually get a really cool perk on your gear that synergizes really well with this build called Empowering Leaping Strike. And at 600 item level, it's going to make it so you deal 17% additional damage to targets slowed by Leaping Strike's Cowardly Punishment upgrade. So basically, if you're able to get a Leaping Strike backstab on someone that's running away and they don't die, they're going to be slowed by 50% for 8 seconds. And if you get a light attack chain on them, that's going to add another 20% slow for 2 seconds after every third attack. And during that window, you're going to be benefiting from the 17% damage from your Empowering Leaping Strike perk, combined with the 20% bonus damage you already get to slowed foes. And if you backstab it, it's going to be a crit, and so you're going to get critical precision, and so you're going to be moving 20% faster for 5 seconds. And so I'm painting this picture because all this stuff put together, if you're able to get good at hitting your Leaping Strike, both going into the fight to set up your shield bash, and also in pursuit to finish someone off, it can be a truly legendary ability, and it has a ton of synergy with the sword kit to make it just blast. Alright, so the final thing to cover combat mechanics wise is blocking with the shield. And you probably notice by now that I don't block much, and that's really because pretty much every time I've played sword and shield before this, it's with a ranged DPS as my other weapon, and so anytime I had space, instead of blocking and trying to close the gap, I would have my ranged weapon out and be trading DPS. And so I'm not that used to blocking, I'm not very good at it, I'm working on it. But in this full dex build, because of how efficient you are with stamina, you really don't need it that much. And since we're limited to a round shield in this medium armor setup, it's not that efficient at blocking anyways. And we also have 0 points in any of the blocking talents, because like I said, we don't really need them, they don't do much for us in this build, especially with a round shield. And we use every talent we can to get sword DPS and enable that DPS with mobility and utility. So really the main time you want to block is if you're closing the gap on a ranged weapon. And so anytime someone's using a bow or a magic weapon or a musket, you got to be careful with musket though, because if they have that stamina damage talent, a lot of times they can just shatter you right away. Also, you want to be careful against bow. The heavy attack from bow can do a similar thing. And so when you're playing against a bow, basically what you want to do is quick block, so just to absorb the light arrows. And the light arrows are not going to do much at all to your stamina. And what you want to watch out for is a heavy attack, so they have to draw back like almost like a full 2 seconds to get a heavy attack off. And when you see someone do that, instead of trying to block it, you really want to try to dodge that. Also, you pretty much never want to try to block like a heavy attack from a warhammer or a spear or a great axe, because that's pretty much always going to shatter your guard in one hit. You can block more efficiently in PvE because stuff doesn't hit your stamina bar as hard, but in PvP, because of your full dex build and how efficient you are with your stamina, with your dodges costing 10 less from the dex perk, as well as costing 10 less because you're in medium armor, so instead of costing 50, your dodge costs 30, and then you're really going to want to pick up the perks on your jewelry, and those are going to give you around 9 to 10 extra stamina on your stamina bar, as well as 9 to 10% extra stamina regeneration. And then also every 10 seconds when you dodge from the final dex perk, you're going to get a guaranteed crit. And so you really want dodge and riposte to be your primary methods of avoiding damage, and only block when you're closing the gap on a ranged weapon or you really need to for some reason. And I think the best way to block in melee that I'm not that good at but would be really good with this build is if you tried to use your block to stop abilities. And so a lot of the melee kits like sword and shield and spear that have a lot of utility, all that utility can be blocked, and it usually doesn't do a ton of stamina damage. And so if you're looking for it and you time it right, a lot of times you can absorb those abilities very efficiently. Alright, so that's kind of the optimal way to work the shield. And super duper final last thing on combat mechanics, just because I forgot to mention it anywhere else, mostly because I didn't actually have the talent myself yet, but you will have freeing justice with your sword as well. And so anytime you're able to successfully land a heavy attack, which not only activates your 30% bonus damage from empowered stab, it's also going to remove one debuff from you. And so if you're in a situation where you get rooted or you get a big burn on you or something like that, if you're able to get a quick heavy attack on anything nearby, you're going to be able to quickly remove that debuff. Boom. All right. Now we all have a deep level of knowledge of rogue combat mechanics. And so now we're going to move into the gearing. So for this, I'm just going to show the gear I was using for pretty much all this video. And in general, you really just want to pick up pieces that have either straight decks, so of the Ranger, or dex and con, so of the Warden or of the Brigand. And then from a weight distribution standpoint, I think the most efficient way to run this build, because you're trying to run a shield in medium armor, is going heavy for two out of the three lighter pieces. And so when you look at gear on your body, you have five slots. You have head, chest, hands, legs, and feet, right? And so in New World, of those five slots, the head, the hands, and the boots are all the same weight. Legs are their own weight, and chest are their own weight. And so like if you look at light armor, a light head, a light hands, and a light feet are all going to weigh the same. Light legs are going to weigh a little bit more. Light chest is going to weigh a little bit more. And same thing with medium, they all just jump up a little bit. And same thing with heavy, they all just jump up a little bit. And so when you're in something like a medium build, you can really mix and match the weight of different pieces to sort of min-max your weight capacity and get the most possible armor that you can without going into heavy. And so for this build, I think the highest value weight distribution is going heavy on two out of the three of the smaller pieces. So on the head, hands, and boots, pick two out of three of those and go heavy. And then for the third one of those, go medium. And then you're going to get a medium chest, light legs, and a round shield. And that's going to put you right under the weight limit for heavy. And so for example, my character, I have a heavy head, medium chest, heavy hands, light legs, medium boots, and a round shield, and that puts me right at 22.9, and the cutoff for heavy is 23, so you're literally as close as you can possibly get to heavy without going into heavy. Something else worth mentioning here is that for a full dex build, you can actually pick up pretty high item level Skinner's Pants for not that much gold, and even though Skinner's Pants say medium on them, they are the weight of light armor, and they have a fat amount of dex on them. And so if you're struggling to find light legs of the Ranger or of the Warden or of the Brigand, you can pick up some Skinner's Pants, and that's what I was wearing throughout this entire video. And even though they say medium, they are the weight of light armor. And the main thing you're gonna miss out on here is a gem slot on your legs and any additional combat perks. So as far as the perks themselves go, I think there's a couple that are really clutch to pick up with this build, and a couple I was actually missing that I really wish I would have had, but I just wasn't able to find gear with the right attributes and the right perks in the time I had to try to put this build together. But I was able to pick up a couple of the main ones. The one that I really missed that I wish I had was the one I mentioned earlier when we were talking about Leaping Strike, and that is the perk called Empowering Leaping Strike. And what that's going to do at max item level is give you 17% additional damage to targets slowed by Leaping Strike's Cowardly Punishment upgrade. So remember, Cowardly Punishment is the final upgrade on your Leaping Strike ability, and what that does is if you hit him in the back, it's going to slow him by 50% for 8 seconds. So during that 8 second window, you're going to be dealing 17% additional damage from your Empowering Leaping Strike. You're also going to be dealing 10% more damage to slowed foes from Opportunist, and all your crits are going to benefit from another 10% on top of that from your 250 dex perk. Another one that's really good that I was able to pick up, but not until later into playing the build, and you'll see it's when I upgraded my chest armor. So I had the faction chest piece for a bit, and then I was able to find a better chest with omnidirectional evade. Sounds like a feature on the new Tesla. And what this is going to do is make it so that evade's adagio upgrade benefits when you go in any direction, not just when you dodge forward. And so by default, adagio makes it so that you gain 15% increased damage on your next light attack, but it only counts if you evade forward. And so omnidirectional evade makes it so that you can go in any direction with your evade and still benefit from that 15% damage on your next light attack from the Adagio upgrade. Another really cool one that I really wish I would have had but didn't get is Accelerated Defiance Stance. And that's gonna make it so that at max item level, after you trigger your Defiance Stance, for 5 seconds you're gonna have 28% extra movement speed. And so for a build like this that's double melee and use Defiance Stance a lot in those situations where your other stuff's on cooldown and you have space and you're either trying to close the gap or get away, and so 28% bonus movement speed for 5 seconds after popping it would actually be insane for this build. So I really recommend trying to grab that one if you can. And so there's two really good ones on jewelry for pretty much any dex build, and that is Hardy and Nimble. And so Hardy at max item level is going to give you 9.6 extra stamina on your stamina bar. So that should round up to 10 extra stamina. So you'll be sitting at 110 stamina base. And then Nimble at max item level is going to make it so you get 9.6% extra stamina regeneration. And so for a build like this, where you're really depending heavily on your dodges to avoid damage, having that extra 10 stamina in your stamina bar along with the extra 10% regeneration really comes in clutch to help you get in that one more life-saving dodge that you need before you run out of stamina. And so you'll be able to find Hardy on a ring, and you'll be able to get Nimble on earrings. And so for your amulet, your neck, I think a safe one is the health perk. And at max item level, that's just going to give you 9.4% max health. And so that can only help in pretty much any build in PvP, just having that little bit of extra health. Another one that I actually found by accident on the amulet, but ended up being pretty clutch for this build, is this Purify. And that makes it so when you're hit at all, when you're below 50% health, you lose all debuffs. And that can happen once every 90 seconds. And so for a build like this, where you're up in the shit, getting down and dirty, getting a full cleanse of all debuffs when you're hit below half health, especially from some of these really aggressive debuff dots in OPR right now, like Powder Burn and the dot from the Void Gauntlet, just ends up coming through really clutch sometimes. And this actually pairs really nicely with your Freeing Justice. And so anytime you heavy attack with your sword, you're going to be losing a debuff as well. And so you can really try to keep yourself purified. I just want to be pure. And then last one on armor, if you're planning on running the PvE version of the build and taking Flurry instead of Fletch, there's a perk called Leeching Flurry that's actually insane. And so at max item level with this perk, each hit of Flurry restores 28% of the damage's health. And you're pretty much always going to be able to set up your Flurry with a backstab in this build. And so all 5 attacks are going to be crits. And so depending on your gear and what you're fighting, a lot of times the total damage from that Flurry can be like 6,000 plus. And so healing for 28% of that is going to be like a little under 1,800 health you're going to be getting back. And so you can just get a massive amount of lifesteal from Flurry. Alright, so now for weapon perks, I think it's pretty straightforward. I think it is pretty much essential that you try to get Keen on your longsword and Rogue on your rapier. And so the Keen perk on your longsword at max item level is going to give you an 11% extra crit chance, and that stacks really nicely with the precision talent that gives your sword and shield an extra 10% crit. And so with just those two things together, you're going to be at an extra 21% crit with your longsword. And the more you're able to crit with your sword, the more you're going to be activating critical precision, which is that 20% haste you get for 5 seconds every time you crit. And for rapier, since this is your primary backstab weapon, and because this is a backstab rogue build, you're really going to want to pick up the perk Rogue, which gives you at max item level up to 19% extra backstab damage. And so for your weapons, my recommendation would be just trying to find the highest item level that you can with those perks. And so the base damage of the weapon is going to scale directly with item level, and the color of the weapon, or the rarity, basically just tells you how many perks are on it. And so you can have a blue 600 item level sword, and you can have a legendary orange item level sword, and they have the same exact base damage, and the only difference is the blue has a gem slot and one perk, the orange has a gem slot and 3 perks. Purple would have a gem slot and 2 perks, but if they're all item level 600, they're all going to have the same base damage. And so basically what you're looking for is the highest item level sword you can find with Keen. And so it can even be a blue sword, but as long as it has Keen and it's a high item level, like mine, it's money. And I actually found this longsword for around 2,000 gold, and it is perfect for this build. Awesome, huge, epic looking model, a gem slot for my emerald, and Keen. And so same thing for the rapier, you're just looking for the highest item level you can find with Rogue on it. And if you happen to pick up a higher rarity, like a purple or an orange, those additional perks can only help. A lot of times they're inconsequential, but every once in a while you can find a really epic legendary roll with all the right stuff on it. And so you can look for that if you're a big spender and you really want to min-max. But basically any high item level rapier with rogue and a gem slot will do. For your shield, I really recommend trying to find one with strength. Because of how the shield works right now, your rapier will never benefit from the base attributes on your shield. And so getting dex to benefit your rapier is pointless. And so the only thing your shield attribute is going to benefit is your longsword, because the only time your shield attributes apply is when it's actually unsheathed. Not even just selected, it has to be unsheathed out. So since longsword scales primarily with strength, and we're already in the upper tier scaling windows of dex, in this build, the most benefit you're going to get out of your shield stat is getting as much strength on it as you can. And that's going to give the most benefit to your longsword possible, because longsword scales primarily with strength, secondarily with dex, and you're already in the upper scaling windows of dex. And so getting some max value strength points in the first scaling window of strength for your longsword from your shield, I think, is the most beneficial thing you can do. And completely by accident, I think I finally found a shield perk that's actually legit. And this is a sleeper, and I literally didn't even realize it worked like this until right now when I was making this section of the video. And I went back and looked at some of the clips in this video and was able to confirm this. And that is the perk Keenly Empowered. And what that does is make it so that when you get a critical with your shield, you're going to get 15% bonus damage for 5 seconds. And so the only attack we have in this build with the shield is Shield Bash. But Shield Bash is the setup for your huge burst combo. And guess what? This might be the only shield perk that applies to your other weapon. Because when I get a crit with my shield on a Shield Bash and I switch to my rapier, this 15% fortify stays on for 5 seconds. And so you're actually going to get 15% more damage on top of the huge backstab numbers that we discussed earlier for bonus damage. So I think the rapier was at 88% bonus damage potential with everything lining up for that backstab off of Shield Bash. So if you get a crit on your Shield Bash with this perk on your shield, you get to add another 15% to that backstab. And so that 88 is going to jump up to 103% bonus damage for that backstab.
I actually just got so stoked right now finding this out. The way shield works has been making me sad.
And so this is at least one little thing with the shield that carries over to your other weapon, and that feels pretty good. All right, so that about does it for the gear. And very last thing I wanted to mention real quick is a perk that I forgot about that synergizes really well with this build as well. And it looks like you can pick this up on pretty much any piece of armor, including your shield, and that is Refreshing Evasion. And that reduces active cooldowns by 0.96% after exiting the dodge animation. And so since we're in a full dex build and dodge is our primary means of avoiding damage, we are dodging a lot, and so you're going to be proccing this cooldown reduction quite a bit. And also this build relies very heavily on its cooldowns. You're not doing too much auto attacking willy-nilly. Most of what you're trying to do is set up off of your abilities. And so the more those abilities are up, the more of these burst combos that you can line up and execute. And so picking up Refreshing Evasion wherever you can, I think, is a really high value perk to make it so you can cycle through your abilities and your burst combos faster. All right, last big section here. I am running out of gas, but I wanted to spend at least a couple minutes for the folks out there that are purely focused on PvE. And if that's the case, I think taking Flurry over Fletch, like we talked about earlier, is a really cool way to make you just an absolute powerhouse in PvE, because you're going to get an ultra monster backstab combo, because not only can you get your normal heavy evade, but you can also get another 5 strikes in from your flurry that on most mobs will all still be backstabs because of how slow mobs are to turn around after you open on them out of a backstab stun. So originally when I had the idea for this build, I really wanted to make flurry work. And it just turns out that it's too slow for PvP to use it reliably as a backstab. People can just dodge out of the way after like the very first hit. And also being a sort of squishy, shifty, high burst double melee, having the additional movement speed of Fletch in PvP is pretty clutch. And so I only played with Flurry for a little bit, so I don't have a ton of good footage, and I didn't really understand the combo fully at that point. And so you can do it like I'm doing here, where essentially you get your stun, do your heavy backstab with a rapier, into a flurry and then into an evade. But I think based on what I know now, a more efficient way would probably be to basically do the same exact thing we were doing in PvP, except instead of where you fletch, you flurry. And so you do your heavy backstab into your instant light backstab, and immediately after that first light attack, you go into your flurry, and that's going to make it so your backstab combo in total is the heavy with the rapier into the evade light into the five attacks with flurry. And so you're actually going to get seven backstabs before the mob has time to turn around. And if you evade first like this before flurry, a lot of times evade will be really close to off cooldown by the time flurry is over. Another thing worth mentioning that we talked about earlier is just that you can block quite a bit more reliably in PvE because mobs don't do quite as much stamina damage as players. And so if you like blocking more than dodging when you're weaving your combos, there's definitely more room for that in the PvE build. And also, if you missed the gearing section of the video, there's also a really clutch perk you can pick up for this PvE version of the build called Leeching Flurry. And that's going to make it so each hit of flurry restores 28% of the damage done as health when you're at max item level with that perk. And so depending on your gear and what you're fighting, a lot of times your flurry, because they're all backstabs, is going to hit for like 5,000-6,000 plus, and so you're going to be healing for 28% of that, and so you can get some really nice lifesteal going off of your flurry in this PvE build. And so I don't have a ton more to add on this. I'm definitely going to be experimenting with this a little more on the side with PvE now that I kind of have figured this build out. But if anyone ends up going this PvE variation and gets to test it out, you know, in like max level dungeons and invasions and stuff like that, I would love to hear about how that is going and your experience with it in the comments if you get a chance. Because I think it's a really insane amount of burst damage that you have compared to a lot of PvE builds. All right, super ultra final, totally last thing I want to talk about is the future of Rogue. I think my favorite thing about this build is how challenging it actually is. And I know that might sound weird to some people, but I think like a lot of things in life, when something is difficult, a lot of times there is a larger reward associated with being able to do it successfully. So like in careers, for example, and the satisfaction that comes from being able to achieve a task that is exceptionally difficult is often amazing. On top of that, I think in a future real world where New World is an esport, which would be so cool and so fun to watch, and so I really hope someone at Amazon Games is sort of leading that vision of how this could be a very competitive and engaging and entertaining esport to watch, especially if they created a gladiator arena for PvP where you could have 1v1s, 2v2s, 3v3s, 5v5s. I would love to see a 10v10 deathmatch. You could have like a 20-man free-for-all, last man standing. You could have dual tournaments. You could have competitive war scenarios where you actually have a full 50 versus 50 competitive team that goes at it in wars. You could have like multi-day land rush tournaments where competitive companies start on a fresh server and they have a certain amount of time to land grab, and whoever holds the most territories like at the end of a week is the victor. You know, you could have competitive OPR if they took those fucking brutes out of there. There's really just a ton of possibility, and it really gets me excited, you know, thinking about that kind of stuff. And when I imagine a future like that, which I hope becomes reality, it makes me think about what kinds of builds would really excel in the different aspects of that scene. And I think for this kind of build, like a rogue sort of build that's really reliant on utility setup and burst, is going to be really strong in the dual tournaments, in the 1v1, 2v2, 3v3 gladiator scenarios, just because of the utility and burst and the way that sort of archetype rises to the top in many competitive games. And so with the teasing we've seen of the daggers that may come to New World in the future, and I'm really hoping the daggers have some sort of backstab-focused talent tree, because, you know, they're fucking daggers. And so I hope and I predict that the daggers will pair very well with either of these weapons for a similar type of backstab rogue-style build. Holy shit balls, we fucking did it. This one was a monster. It took me forever.
I really love making videos like this, but it takes so long.
This one felt really epic and really different than anything I've played so far, and I had an absolute blast with it, and definitely a build that I'm going to be keeping in the back pocket and continuing to practice, because I think it has really high potential in the future of New World, especially if they introduce daggers. And so anyways, welcome to my first light chill pad. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I hope you are having an excellent day or night wherever you are, and I'll be really curious to hear your feedback on this build if you end up trying it, because I kind of only have my limited perspective on it.
I don't know anyone else that's played it or tried anything like this, and so it would be really cool to see what other people think of it once they kind of give it a go.
All right, that's it for this one. I will catch you in the Shield Archer guide, which will be coming fairly soon. I have most of the gameplay clips for that, and so I'll just be working on the edit for the next week or so, and hopefully be able to get that one out to you guys pretty soon as well. So thanks again for watching. I really appreciate you. Take care of yourself, and I hope you have an amazing winter convergence. Is that what it's called? Yeah. So happy winter's convergence. Peace.